Hello friends, today we are going to discuss an important topic of hiatus hernia, which has got multimodal presentations and multimodal pathoetiology. So it is the herniation of the gastroesophageal junction and stomach and esophagus through the esophageal hiatus into the thoracic cavity, you can say for practical purpose in the posterior mediastinum. So it has got varied types, mostly sliding hernia, the rolling hernia, and a mixture of these two is called as mixed hiatal hernias. So, sliding hernia. So, we have got three modalities of the hernia. So, basically, it mainly depends, differentiation is depending on the anatomical and pathoanatomical location of the gastroesophageal junction and along the hiatus, whatever structures which are herniating in the thorax. So, we have got the first variety, the sliding hernia. It is the hernia in which the gastroesophageal junction migrates into the posterior mediastinum or the thoracic cavity through the esophageal opening in the diaphragm. So the patient may present with the symptoms of the gastroesophageal reflux disease, which has got the treatment relating to the GERD or GORD. The second variety is the paraesophageal, or it is also called as rolling type of hiatus hernia. By words itself, they are explanatory, rolling. What you mean by rolling? The rolling means something which rolls besides the esophageal hiatus. It's called as rolling hernia. So, cardioesophageal junction is displaced, undisplaced. So, the cardioesophageal junction is undisplaced. The rolling hernia is a true hernia and is prone for complications, and hence it is dangerous. Sometimes, whole of the stomach may lie in the thorax or mediastinum, or it may undergo volvulus and perforation and gangrene if it is blood supply gets hampered. So, we just see what is the differentiation between these two on the board. So, this is the diaphragm. This is the normal cardioesophageal junction location. This is the sliding type of hernia. In rolling type, so this is the normal cardioesophageal junction and its location in normal, as seen in normal anatomy. But in sliding hernia, as you can see, the cardioesophageal junction migrates upwards. So the part of the upper part of the stomach and cardia gets herniated in the posterior mediastinum. But as in rolling hernia, as you can see, there is cardioesophageal junction does not get displaced from its normal location. So only the herniation of the fundus of the stomach along besides the hiatus. So in some cases, apart from stomach, colon or intestine, other small bowel also may get herniated in the mediastinum, as in case of paraesophageal or rolling type of hernia. But in majority of the cases, we may get mixed variety, which is the combination of both. That is, besides the displacement of this cardioesophageal junction, you may get herniation of the stomach in the thorax, or any of the colon or any of the small bowel may get herniated in the thorax. So the complications depend on this. If this gets herniated in the thorax, the pinch cock or diaphragm, whenever there is constriction, this part of the stomach which has got herniated in the thorax will get lack of blood supply. So it may undergo strangulation and perforation and necrosis. So all the complications of these two are related with these two varieties. So colon and small intestine may sometimes lie in the sac. Commonest it is in elderly, but may occur in young or fit patients. Majority of the rolling hernias are mixed hernias in which the cardia is displaced in the chest and the greater curvature of the stomach also rolls back in the mediastinum. So what are the symptoms of these hernias? So these are due to twisting and distortion of the esophagus and the stomach. So mainly the patient may present with dysphagia or chest pain. It is related to the fullness in the retrosternal area because of the herniated part. So the stomach may get obstructed and the pain is relieved by the loud belch. So reflex is uncommon in rolling type of paraesophageal hernia, and as the gastroesophageal junction is normally located and functions normally. This is very important point, because reflux is not common in cases of paraesophageal or rolling type of hernia, but it is common in sliding type of hernia because of displacement of the cardioesophageal junction. As the cardioesophageal junction gets migrated in the thorax, and normal protective mechanisms of the lower esophageal junction are hampered. So what are the complications of hiatal hernia? The complications of the hiatal hernia are related to these two varieties, the sliding and rolling type paraesophageal. So esophagitis is common due to reflux in cases of sliding hiatus hernia because of the migration of the cardioesophageal junction But in rolling paraesophageal hernia, hemorrhage, incarceration and obstruction and strangulation is common, as you can see in this figure, because of the constriction and strangulation of the part of the stomach which has got herniated. Barrett's esophagus and consequences of the Barrett's esophagus like adenocarcinoma is common in cases of sliding hernia because of the associated reflux which may cause the Barrett's esophagus and lead to adenocarcinoma. Aspiration and its complications like pneumonitis are common in cases of sliding hernia because of the contents of the stomach may get regurgitated back in the thorax, back in the esophagus. Dyspnea for mechanical complication is common in cases of paraesophageal or rolling type of hernia because of the compression of the lung by the herniated stomach or any of the colon or small bowel contents which lies in the mediastinum or along the esophagus. So what are the investigations we have? So first and foremost remains the radiological investigation, which is X-ray chest, which will show the gas bubble which is often filled with the fluid in cases of paraesophageal or rolling hernia. It will show the gas bubble filled with the fluid in cases of paraesophageal hernia. But fluid levels are not seen in sliding hernia because the gastroesophageal junction migrates upwards and there is no part of the stomach has herniated in the mediastinum so as to reveal a fluid or bubble level in the posterior mediastinum. So these two important factors, the gastric bubble is absent in sliding type of hernia and gastric bubble is present in the thorax in paraesophageal or rolling type of hernia. So barium meal is the best method of diagnosis of these hiatal hernias. Best method is diagnosed by the Trendelenburg position, which will give the exact herniation of the part of the stomach or any of the paraesophageal content in the barium meal. So apart from barium swallow, we have got endoscopy, and the endoscopic appearance may be confusing, especially in large hernias when the endoscopist finds as if he has lost his way or lost his sense of direction in the stomach or in the esophagus, because whenever there is herniation, large herniation of the stomach or part of stomach in the thorax, the endoscopist may not find that it is the normal anatomical location of the different areas of the stomach while doing endoscopy. Esophageal manometry and 24 hour pH recording are very important and essential from point of view of the treatment of the patient. So whether after reduction of this hernia, whether this hernia should be reinforced with fundoplication or not, what is the amount of gastroesophageal reflux that is associated with, we should be able to correct with fundoplication. So it is for confirmation of diagnosis, it should be done before planning anti-reflux operation and should be done at the same setting. So gastroesophageal manometry and 24-hour pH metry should be done simultaneously, one by each other. So what are the treatments we have got? Rolling type of hernias always require surgical repair as they are potentially dangerous, as we saw earlier, because they are likely to complicate by strangulation and perforation. So acute chest pain, when your patient presents to you with rolling hernia with acute chest pain and you are diagnosed it on X-ray, first thing is to put a rice tube, relieve the compression on the stomach and the patient will get relief of pain immediately. So it should be followed by surgery. If the pain is not relieved, suspect some other further complication like strangulation and perforation, and it should be taken for operation immediately. Type of operation is controversial. Thoracic or abdominal approach, both are acceptable. You may begin with abdominal approach if you find that this is to be extended to the thorax, you may convert or you may add a thoracotomy. The essential part of operation is a reduction of the hernia and some form of gastropexy so as to prevent recurrence. Sometimes a mesh can be used to reinforce if the defect is too much large also. Some surgeons perform a fundoplication, arguing that it is very effective method of maintaining the reduction and also deals with the associated GRD. Mind well, you should have documented this before on manometry or pH metry to add a fundoplication. So laparoscopic repair has now become popular, and more commonly simple repair of hernia and gastropexy is done. So friends, in this lecture of hiatus hernia, we saw various types of hiatus hernia and their complications and how to differentiate between these two, because both these two things are very much closely related, but they have different complications and they have different modalities of treatment. Thank you.